How are you guys doing? Today is Saturday, February 20th, 2021, out here in this quarantine. I'm James Sims, and for this episode of The Elite, I'm going to do an individual profile on Justin Verlander, who is number 35. He is the ace, or if you don't know what the ace means, he is the best starting pitcher for the Houston Astros, who has had an amazing MLB career, of course, from the beginning up until now, and because his career is probably more extensive, is more accomplished than a lot of the elite profiles that I have on my list, I chose to make Justin Verlander's a GO profile because he's one of the greatest players to ever play the game. And of course, with that said, I'm going to go a little bit into depth into why I think Justin Verlander is one of the greatest pitchers to ever play the game, and especially for the 2021 calendar year, why I think he's still one of the amazing players to keep your eye on, especially as we get ready to enter this upcoming MLB season. So, if you're unfamiliar with Justin Verlander, kind of like I just said, he's just a very controlled pitcher. He knows what he's doing. And because a lot of pitching is mental and a lot of it is strategy, he's very great at he's really good at strategizing a game plan against the pitcher. And of course, he's really good at just just gliding the ball past the hitter in a way that not a lot of pitchers do. And if you're not familiar, and players like this don't win multiple Cy Youngs, and pitchers don't win MVP trophies unless they're really, really, really amazing at their craft. So I'm going to go through his career, and I'm just going to let his stats and accolades and accomplishments speak for themselves. I'm going to let his numbers speak as to why this man has not only an elite profile, but a GOAT one. So Justin Verlander, originally coming out of Virginia, eventually he would go to high school at Old Dominion, and while he was at Old Dominion, he would break records. He used to break single season records for his seasons, and he finished as the all-time career strikeout leader at Old Dominion once he was finished there after his three seasons, and during his 3 years, he averaged 11.5 strikeouts per 9 innings. His ERA for his career was 2.57 at Old Dominion, and after winning a silver medal at the Pan American Games, he would be drafted second overall in the 2004 MLB draft by the Detroit Tigers. And after a short stint, he would eventually get called up to play for the Detroit Tigers in 2005, which would be his age 22 season. In 2005, he would go on to start both of the games that he would play in for that season. He would pitch 11 innings in a season where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the fourth best record in the AL Central at 71-91. This wouldn't officially be his rookie year, but of course, in the 11 innings that he would pitch, he would allow 15 hits in those 11 innings, more hits than innings pitched. He allowed 9 runs in those 11 innings, walking 5, striking out 7. Of course, not much to go on, but of course, that would be his first taste of the MLB, and that happened all the way back in 2005, before my younger sister was even born. But with that, I feel like with all that he had gathered in his first little 11 innings, he would come back a little stronger the second season. So in his first full season in the MLB in 2006, he would start 30 games in a season where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the second best record in the American League Central. They would go 95-67, as of course they would make the playoffs. And this is when the Detroit Tigers were going insane. Their manager Jim Leyland would win Manager of the Year this season. And for Justin Verlander, within the 30 games that he would start, he would complete one full game. He would finish with a 17-9 record, a 3.63 ERA in 186 innings, where he would allow 187 hits, which is one more hit than innings pitched, which is a very impressive feat for a pitcher. He would allow 75 earned runs in those 186 innings he would strike out 124 batters in 186 innings, and he would go on to finish 7th in the Cy Young race, 15th in the MVP voting, and he would finish as the American League Rookie of the Year in the season of 2006. So within his first season, he had established himself as one of the best rookies, and he was most definitely coming for that top pitching spot. But Of course, in his rookie season, the Tigers would go to the playoffs. They would beat the Yankees in the American League Division Series 3-1. And this is when the Yankees were incredibly good. This is when A-Rod was on the team. They would go on to sweep the Oakland Athletics in the ALCS to go to the World Series against the St. Louis Cardinals. And then they would lose to the St. Louis Cardinals. Of course, Albert Pujols. And this would be the year that they would have Chris Carpenter and all of... They would lose to a very, very great... St. Louis Cardinals team, but of course Justin Verlander's presence was most definitely being felt as a rookie, and many people were aware that he was continuing to get better and better. But after his first year, the entire MLB, or at least the American League, was aware of the stuff that he could do. So, and then just following 2006, he would transition into his age 24 season in 2007, where he would start 32 games in a season where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the second best record in the American League Central. They would miss the playoffs completely, but of course in the season, in those 32 games, Justin Verlander would finish with an 18-6 record as a starting pitcher. He would go on to finish with a 3.66 ERA, which is a slight tad higher than it was the previous season. This would be the first season he pitched for 200 innings. He pitched for 201.2, allowing 181 hits, less hits than innings pitched, for the first time in his career. He would strike out 183 batters, which would be the first time he had more strikeouts than hits allowed as a pitcher. He would lead all pitchers in times he hit the batter. And hit by pitch, and he led the league in wild pitches, but at the same time, he would go on to make the first All-Star game in his career as he finished fifth in Cy Young voting. And even though the Tigers would completely miss the playoffs, he was slowly but surely getting close, and he would go on to pitch his very first no-hitter in his career. And yeah, so I mean, like, he was starting to put together amazing performances. But with him leading the league in wild pitches and hit by pitch, he was still putting everything together. But with this being his first of his 8 All-Star appearances, this was definitely the start of something. It was the beginning of something amazing for Justin Verlander. So this would transition into his 2008 season, which was probably one of his worst seasons as a starting pitcher to date. In this season, in 2008, in his age 25 season, Justin Verlander would start 33 games in a season where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the fifth best record in the AL Central, at 74-88, which would be 14 less wins than the previous season, which they actually flipped records from 2007. And of course, in this season, Justin Verlander would finish with an 11-17 record. He led the American League in losses. He would finish with a 4.84 ERA, which of course he's never had an ERA that would be the highest ERA he put up in a full season in his MLB career. He would pitch 201 innings for the second time in his career. He would allow 195 hits, which is less hits than innings pitched. He struck out 163 batters. He had less strikeouts than hits allowed. In that season, as he was still putting everything together, but this would be the time at which most people in the MLB world, they kind of doubted whether Justin Verlander would kind of keep it together. And I mean, this would eventually fuel him. This would lead into the 2009 campaign, where Justin Verlander would go on a crazy All-Star streak where many people would start to recognize him as one of the best pitchers in the game. So, in his age 26 season, Justin Verlander would start all 35 games he would play in a season where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the second best record in the division at 86-77. They would miss the playoffs yet again as they were one game behind. They lost their division by one game. But of course, in this season, Justin Verlander in the 35 games, he would finish with a 19-9 record and a 3.45 ERA. This would be the lowest ERA he'd ever posted in a full season. He would lead the American League, of course, in games started 35, and with that and with the and And he would lead the league in wins for the first time with 19. He would lead the American League in innings pitched with 240 innings pitched, the most innings he'd ever pitched in a season. He allowed 219 hits. It would be the first time he allowed 200 hits in a season, but it would still, and this would be the second time in his MLB career he allowed less hits than innings pitched. He struck out 269 batters, the first time he struck out even more than 200 in his career. This would be the first time he led the American League in strikeouts, and he would lead the league in batters faced as well, and he led the league in strikeouts per nine innings. He struck out 10 batters per nine innings. This would be the only time in which he had done so in his career. He would go on to make his second All-Star game in his career as he finished third in Cy Young voting. And even though the Tigers missed the playoffs, being a he was a two-time All-Star within his first four full seasons in the MLB, which of course means that his All-Star campaign the first time was not a coincidence. And I think after this, he was able to kind of fine tune his game to kind of understand what worked and what didn't. So this would fuel his 2010 season, which would be fuel his age 27 season, which would be in 2010, where he would pitch, or he would start 33 games and finish with an 18-9 record in a season where the Detroit Tigers finished with an 81-81 record. They would finish third in their division. They finished 13 games out of the very top, but Justin Verlander in this season would finish with an 18-9 record, like I just said, finishing with a 3.37 ERA, which at this point was the lowest he had ever put up as a starter in a full season. Also, he would pitch four complete games. This would be the second, or the previous year he pitched three, so this would be the second time he had at least more than one complete game. And of course, he was 27, so of course he could actually last the entire game. He pitched 224 innings. This would be the second most amount of innings he would pitch in a season. He allowed 190 hits in this season. He would strike out 219 batters, so this would be yet another season he allowed less hits than innings pitched. This would be the third year in a row, this would be the fourth year in a row in which he had done that, and he had struck out 219 batters. This would be the second time he struck out 200 batters in his career, and for the second year in a row, and for the third time in 4 years, he was named to an All-Star game as he went on to finish 11th in Cy Young voting. Even though the Tigers wouldn't make it, this would lead probably into arguably his best season as a starting pitcher, and one that would kind of go down in the history books for all pitchers that have ever played the game. So, leading into 2011, his age 28 season, he would start 34 games in a season where the Detroit Tigers finished with the best record in the American League Central. They finished with a 95-67 record, which would be the same record they finished with when he was a rookie and they went to the World Series. Of course, this would also be, or this is also a season where you see Miguel Cabrera start to heat up, but specifically in this season, he would, in those 34 games, let's not remember, he played 34 games. He would finish with a 24-5 record. This would be the most wins he had ever put up in a season in his career. He led the American League in wins. He would finish with a 2.40 ERA. So, of course, he finished with the best ERA in the American League. He would lead the league in innings pitched with 251, and that would be the most innings he'd ever pitched in a season in his career. He allowed 174 hits, which is the least amount of hits he allowed in a full season in his career, despite the fact that he's pitched the most innings he'd ever pitched in his career. He will go on to strike out 250 batters. It would be the second most amount of strikeouts he'd ever have in his career, and this would be a season in which he'd have less strikeouts than innings pitched. But of course, he would lead in walks/hits per innings pitched with .920. He would go on to make in the 34 games that he would play, he would lead the American League in wins, ERA, and strikeouts, which is a triple crown, which is something that pitchers don't normally do. So this is an incredible feat. So this is why it goes down as arguably his best season, inarguably his best season. By winning the American League Triple Crown as a pitcher, he would go on to, of course, make his third straight All-Star game, his fourth in five seasons. His fourth in five seasons, which after winning Rookie of the Year, he would win the Cy Young for the first time in his career in the American League, and he would go on to win the MVP, which is something that pitchers don't normally do, because in the season he only played 34 of the 162 games. But in those there's 34 games were incredibly flawless, and this would be a year unlike any other in which you see a pitcher win the MVP, something that I think I've only seen Clayton Kershaw do in my lifetime, which is one of the reasons that Justin Verlander has a GOAT profile, because this season alone solidifies him as one of the greatest pitchers to ever play the game. So, following this season, where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the best record in the American League Central, they would go on to beat the New York Yankees in the American League Divisional Series, and they would go on to lose to the Rangers in the ALCS in a season where the Rangers would lose to the St. Louis Cardinals eventually in the World Series. But of course, with this season, Justin Verlander winning with all the accolades that he could possibly have won, 2011, you'd think that you'd never see another season quite like that. But of course, he would continue to build off that amazing season, as after that, I feel like after that season, he had established himself as a Hall of Fame level pitcher, because at that point, he had already, that was already his fourth All-Star game in a five-year stretch. But so everything after that, it was just kind of extra. The only thing left he had to win was a championship. So going into 2012, in his age 29 season, he would start 33 games in a season where the Tigers would finish with an 88-74 record, with the second best record in the division for the second year in a row. In this season, Justin Verlander would finish with a 17-8 record and a 2.64 ERA, the second lowest ERA in his career, or the second lowest ERA up until that point in his career, the second time in his career in which he had pitched an ERA sub 3. He would lead the league in complete games for the first time in his career, as he pitched 6 of them. He has never pitched more in his career. He would lead the American League in innings pitched with 238.1. This is the second time in his career in which he had done that. And at the same time, this would be the sixth season in a row in which he had pitched at least 200 innings. He allowed 192 hits in those 238 innings, which is yet another season in which he had done so. He had been doing that every year since his rookie season. He will go on to strike out 239 batters. This would be another season in which he would strike out more batters than he would have innings pitched. This would be the second time in his career which he had done so. It will be the third time that he had led the American League in strikeouts. He also led the league in batters faced, as well as he would finish as an All-Star. He would finish as the runner-up in the Cy Young Award, and this would be the year that, of course, that David Price would win it for the Tampa Bay Rays, but Justin Verlander once again was in that race. He very easily could have won it a second year in a row had David Price not had quite possibly one of the greatest seasons ever. In this season, after finishing with the best record in the American League Central, they would go on to beat the Oakland A's in the ALDS. They would sweep the Yankees at the ALCS, and they would lose to the Giants. They would get swept by the Giants in the World Series when the San Francisco Giants were on their championship tear. And this would also be the season where Miguel Cabrera won the MVP, and he got the Triple Crown, which would be leading the league in batting average, home runs, and RBIs for the entire American League. So, of course, with Justin Verlander and Miguel Cabrera being the 1-2 punch, the Tigers were the most formidable team in the American League, and it made sense that they made it to the World Series. But the Giants were just a better team and a more dominant team at the time, and the Tigers were just so close. And up until that point, Justin Verlander was still a championship away from being solidified as one of the greatest players to ever play in the history of the game. So that would transition into his age 30 season in 2013, where he would lead the American League in starts for the third time in his career. He would start 34 games in a season where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the best record in the American League Central for the third year in a row at 93-69, 5 more wins than the previous season. Verlander would finish with a 13-12 record, as he finished with a 3.46 ERA, pitching for 218 innings. This would be the seventh season in a row he pitched over 200 innings, allowing 212 hits, striking out 217 batters, of course, one less batter than he had innings pitched. And of course, he would make an All-Star game for the fifth year in his for the fifth year in a row, and the fifth time or the sixth time in 7 years in his 8-year career. So of course, we're getting 6 All-Stars in your first 8 seasons. That would solidify almost any player as an all-time great. And going into the playoffs, the Detroit Tigers would go on to beat the they beat the Athletics in the ALDS, and they lost to the Red Sox in the ALCS. And the Red Sox would go on to win the World Series that year. And this would be the year that Miguel Cabrera would win a back-to-back MVP, and Max Scherzer would establish himself as the best pitcher for the Detroit Tigers this season. And Max Scherzer was the Cy Young Award winner. And this would be a year in which the Tigers had 2 Cy Young winners on one team. Verlander wasn't dealing it as much as Max Scherzer was, but he would yet again make another All-Star game as he tried to get the Tigers back into contention. In 2014, his age 31 season, Justin Verlander would start all 32 games in a season where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the best record in the American League Central for the fourth year in a row. And this would be the last time the Tigers had actually made the playoffs in their team's franchise history. And let you guys know, but in 2014, Verlander would finish with a 15-12 record and a 4.54 ERA. This would be the second highest ERA he had ever put up in his career since his 2008 season, which would be his third full season into the league. He would pitch 206 innings. Yet another year, he would pitch over 200 innings. He allowed 223 hits in those 206 innings, the first time he'd allowed more hits than innings since his rookie season. So that was... this would be a season where not everything was together. He led the American League in earned runs allowed, as he allowed 104 of them, the second most earned runs he'd allowed ever in his career. He would strike out 159 batters in those 206 innings, as of course he was dealing with a lot of... I mean, because he was dealing with coming off of 6 out of 7 All-Star seasons, and of course he would miss the All-Star game for the first time since 2008, as he was trying to get everything together. And then the season, the Detroit Tigers would, in the playoffs, they would get swept by the Baltimore Orioles, and ever since, the Detroit Tigers have never made the playoffs since, leaving their last active championship in 1984. The 1984 was the last time they won the national they won the World Series. But with Justin Verlander there, they had made the World Series twice, but they just weren't good enough in 2006 against the Cardinals, or in 2012 against the San Francisco Giants. So this would lead into a season stretch in which Verlander would not make the playoffs until he left Detroit. So in 2015, Justin Verlander would, or in his age 32 season, Verlander would start 20 games and would be riddled with injuries in a season where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the fifth best record in the American League Central at 74-87, where they would lose 16 more games than the previous season. And within this season, Justin Verlander would finish with a 5-8 record, a 3.38 ERA, which would be a lot lower than the previous year he had. In the 133 innings he pitched, he allowed 113 hits, and he struck out 113 batters. As, of course, not everything was there, the Detroit Tigers would miss a season. This would lead into his next season in 2016, where he would pitch a more of a full season. He would start 34 games in a season where the Detroit Tigers would finish with the second-best record in the American League Central at 86-75, which is the best record that the Tigers have had since. They haven't won more than 65 games in a season since 2016. In this season, Justin Verlander would finish with a 16-9 record, a 3.04 ERA, which is the lowest ERA he'd had since 2012. And he would go on to pitch 227 innings, allowing 171 hits and leading the American League in strikeouts with 254. He led the league in strikeouts for the fourth time in his career. This would be the third time in his career he put up at least 250 strikeouts in a season. And he led the league in walks/hits per innings pitched, finishing second in the Cy Young race as he was getting back into Cy Young form, as he missed the All-Star game yet again in his career because he had an amazing second half of the season. And this would be the last full season that Justin Verlander had put up in a Detroit Tigers uniform. So this would transition into 2017. So for the first chunk of the season, so I wouldn't even say half, he played for about 3/4, maybe 4, like maybe 70-80% of the season. And in this season, he would start 33 games, Well, he would start 33 games overall. He would start 28 games for the Detroit Tigers in a season where they would finish with the fifth best record in the American League Central at 64-98. And then while the Tigers were on their way to having possibly one of their worst seasons ever in Detroit, he would finish with a 10-8 record with a 3.82 ERA. In this season, he would allow 153 hits in 172 innings, striking out 176 batters in Detroit. So, of course, returning to rough Cy Young form. And before the end of the season, he would make the transition. He would make the leap to the Houston Astros, and he would start five games in the season where the Houston Astros would end up with the best record in the American League West at 101-61, the best record that the Astros had put up since 1998, a season where they lost in the NLDS to the Padres. So leading off this moment, in the five games that he would play for Houston, he would finish with a 106 ERA in those 34 innings. He would allow 17 hits. He struck out 43 batters as he would lead the Houston Astros into the playoffs. This would be the season where Jose Altuve finished with the MVP. They would end up beating the Red Sox in the American League Division Series 3-1. They would beat the Yankees 4-3 in the ALCS to earn a spot in the World Series. And this is the season where Aaron Judge was having his breakout rookie season, and they would go on to beat the Los Angeles Dodgers in the World Series 4-3. And it was found out after the fact that the Houston Astros had in fact cheated, but they had gotten immunity from the MLB because, of course, the MLB had not known how they had done it. They offered them immunity to tell them how they had done it, and then they admitted that they did it. By admitting how they had done it and by getting immunity, the Astros still are able to claim the 2017 MLB World Series. And of course, Justin Verlander, even on that playoff run, was the ALCS MVP as he completely shut out the New York Yankees in that series. And for the first time and the only time in his career, Justin Verlander had won. He had won the award that had long eluded his grasp, which was the Cy Young Award. And the fact that up until this point, that was the only thing that he was missing. And I think with winning that World Series champion, he was already a Cy Young Award winner and a World Series champion, and he had established himself as one of the greatest pitchers of all time. But at the same time, he still continued to grow off of that season. So this would transition into his age 35 season, where Justin Verlander would start all 35 games in a season where the Astros would finish with a 103-59 record, which would be a better win total than the year before. And up until that point, they had never won 103 games as a franchise, so that would be a team record. And of course, this would be the season where Dallas Keuchel won the Gold Glove, but within this season, Justin Verlander would finish with a 16-9 record as he would finish with a 2.52 ERA, which is the lowest ERA he had put up since his MVP season in 2011. He would lead the American League in shutouts. He had only one of them on the season. He pitched 214 innings pitched. He allowed 156 hits, which is the least amount of hits that he had allowed in a season, including his MVP season. And he would strike out 290 batters, which is more strikeouts than he had ever put up in a season in his career. He would finish as an all-star. He would make his first all-star game since 2013, which would be a five-year hiatus, or one, two, three, four. This would be the first time in 5 years in which he had made the all-star game. He finishes the runner-up in the Cy Young voting for the first time since 2016. And he would finish 10th in MVP voting, as in the playoffs, the Houston Astros would beat the Indians, but they would lose to the Red Sox the season that the Red Sox would go on to win the World Series. So that's just a little look into how the Houston Astros were playing. So, of course, after winning the World Series, they would lose to the eventual champions. This would transition them into 2019, which would go down as Verlander's other best season, even though this season has some comp. So in 2019, in Justin Verlander's age 36 season, I mean, he's 38 now, just to give you a hint, 36 season, to his second to last full season as a pitcher in his last, or his second to last season as a pitcher in his last full season as a starting pitcher in the MLB, he would go on to start 34 games in a season where the Houston Astros would finish with a 107-55 record, which is still, which, because they were improving their win total over the last three seasons, this would be the most wins that the Astros had ever put up in a season in their franchise history. In this season, Justin Verlander would finish with a 21-6 record. He would lead the American League in wins. He would finish with a 2.58 ERA, which is slightly higher than the season that he would have before, but this would be the fourth season in his career and the most recent season in his career that he would put a sub-3 ERA season. He would lead the American League in innings pitched with 223, and then this would be the fourth time in which he had led the American League in innings pitched. He finished with 137 hits allowed, which would be the least amount of hits he allowed in a full season in which he had played in which he had pitched at least 200 innings. And he would go on to, he didn't lead the league, but he would set a career high with 300 strikeouts in a season. He would go on to make an all-star team. This would be the eighth all-star team that he would make. He would finish 11th in MVP voting, but he would go on to win his second ever Cy Young in his career, which I think solidified him in the GOAT conversation, because not only did he win a championship for one of the greatest teams to ever play in the history of the game and one of the greatest World Series to ever play in the history of the game, he will go on. He's also a player that's won the Cy Young Award twice in the American League, and the first time he won the Cy Young Award, he was an MVP. But going back to the 2019 season, after winning the Cy Young Award, and this would also be the season where Jordan Alvarez won Rookie of the Year, they would go on to beat the Rays in the ALDS 3-2. They beat the Yankees 4-2 in the ALCS to go to the World Series. And they would eventually lose to the Washington Nationals, who caught a lot of momentum. They would, and just behind Anthony Rendon and Max Scherzer, his former teammate, along with young Juan Soto, the Washington Nationals would get the better of the Houston Astros, which would make Justin Verlander's all-time World Series record 1-3. But regardless, in 2019, he was also able to enter the 3,000 strikeout club. In 2019, he is the only current active MLB player that has actually that broke through that threshold. And at the same time, he was able to accomplish his third no-hitter in his career in 2019 as well. He would make the All-MLB first team, the first time they had ever done first teams in his career. And just continuing on, Justin Verlander, this would be the last professional season in which he had put up in his career. And then in 2020, after only pitching six games, he would injure his right groin. He had to undergo surgery, and this was during a shortened season, so there wasn't enough time in the season for him to possibly come back. And then he eventually went out with a forearm strain. He would undergo Tommy John surgery, and at the beginning of the season, he would miss the entire season. And in those six innings, say he would allow three hits and two runs on the season, as of course he wouldn't win any awards because he only pitched six innings. But with that said, when you look at Justin Verlander right now, I think this is definitely a player deserving of a GOAT profile, and he's definitely elite as of right now, considering his last full season. He helped the Astros finish with the best record in the American League, and he will go on to win his second Cy Young in his career at age 36, so that should give a little bit of an idea into how dominant and amazing Justin Verlander has been as an individual player. Taking a look at where he currently stands, he's definitely still the ace on an Astros roster. There still has Zach Greinke, Christian Javier listed, Lance McCullers Jr., and let's not forget they still have one of the best hitting rosters in all of baseball. They still have Jose Altuve. They still have Carlos Correa. They have Michael Brantley. They still have Jordan Alvarez. And this is definitely a team that is very formidable. Not to mention Alex Bregman. This is a team that is a threat to make it to the World Series this year. And with that said, do not be surprised if you see Justin Verlander starting in the World Series, because he is definitely a player that, even though he plays 30-35 games in a season, he has some impact in whether his teams win. And for this reason, I believe he is deserving of not only an elite profile but a GOAT one, because let me go down this again. with 3,000 strikeouts. So for the record, he has 3,013, which is second most, or no, which is the most out of all active pitchers. He has 300 more than his former teammate Max Scherzer, who plays for the Washington Nationals, who also has a who I'm also going to give a goated profile. But with all those strikeouts in mind, and the fact that he entered the 3,000 strikeout club with an MVP under his belt as a pitcher, and not to mention being named to the first All MLB first team, being a World Series champion, being a two-time Cy Young Award winner 9 years apart, by the way, being a Triple Crown winner earning the Triple Crown in 2011. Let's not forget he was also the Rookie of the Year his first full year in the league. This is the guy that's led the league in wins 3 times. He led the league in ERA his MVP season. He would lead the league in strikeouts 5 times. And even when he topped 300 strikeouts in a season, he didn't lead the league in strikeouts that season, but I still think he deserves to be recognized for that. And to mention, he's one of the few players in MLB history that's logged 3 no-hitters in their career. So, I mean, there's not much more to prove from this guy. And with that said, I think his numbers and his accolades and his achievements speak for themselves. So if you ever get a chance, check out my boy Verly, who's currently wearing number 5 for the Houston Nationals. With that said, I want to thank everybody for listening to all 35... I'm going to leave that for a second. 35 minutes of this piece. I hope all is well. And then I will catch you with an elite profile after this for Ciro Immobile, the starting striker for Lazio and of the Italian national team. Thanks once again for listening to my piece. I hope all is well. Today is Saturday, February 20th. I'm out here in this quarantine. Happy 38th birthday to Justin Verlander. I hope all is well. And I will catch you with a piece after this. Peace.